Macmillan Audio presents Dead People Suck, A Guide for Survivors of the Newly Departed by Laurie Kilmartin. Read for you by the author. This book is dedicated to my mom, who probably won't get this much ink when she dies.
You guys have lost a parent yet. I'm sure some people have lost a parent yet. It's, yes, you. First of all, I'm not going to make fun of you. I'm sorry for your loss. It's a genuine feeling. It was a few years ago, but it's still jarring, and it's tough to lose a parent. And it's even tougher if you were hoping to lose the other parent first. Yeah, that's what I learned. And I'm not the only one who feels that way. My dad's last words to me were, "Ha ha, she's your problem now." What a prophet he was, because my mom is my problem now. My 79-year-old mother, a couple months ago, she moved in with me. Yeah. All of those noises you made, that's the feeling I have every single morning when I wake up. It's temporary because she's 79. Please, God. I have to put socks on her feet every morning, and she has her left foot is all five toes stacked on top of each other, like a hoof. And the right foot is two sets of toes on each other, and then a big toe sticking out like a claw. And she just clomps around the house all day long, hoof claw, like a mythical creature from Pan's Labyrinth, asking me what time I'm coming home. She wears a DNR bracelet, a do not resuscitate bracelet. I put it on her. She can't get it off. I hear her trying at night, gnawing away at it. I'm like, good luck, dentures don't cut. So that thing is staying on. I just installed a grab rail in my mom's shower. It is loose. Those were my explicit instructions to the handyman. He assures me it has no more than three grabs left. So there could be another book in a year, guys. my son was 7 when my dad died, and he was, you know, as he is now at age 11, incredibly obsessed with video games. And even at the funeral, he was pestering me for my iPhone so he could play Minecraft, and I wouldn't give it to him. And then we had this one conversation later where my dad had lung cancer. That's what killed him. And my son said, "How did Grandpa get lung cancer?" And I said, "Well, honey, he quit a long, long time ago, but for many, many years, Grandpa played Minecraft." Tiny victories at a funeral, really. Okay, cool. So let's start reading this motherfucker. I will start with the author's note. And author's note. Much of the advice in Dead People Suck is terrible, and some of it is probably illegal. My sincere hope is that it helps you, the griever, pass time in the subway or on the toilet. The fact that our loved ones die at all is an outrage that should be addressed by Congress or the Justice League. I am desperate to see my dad again, so I'm counting on there being a robust post-death afterlife. If there's not, I will be livid, and then I will be dead. All jokes aside, I wish you didn't need to listen to this book, and I am sorry for your loss. All right, you guys are easy to please, which, no, wait till you guys finish ordering. Yeah, the waffle fries really.
We're out of the Lagunitas.
Oh, I know. Believe me, I know what the priorities of this group. We'll stop any sort of reading if you guys aren't getting the alcohol you need. We're promised. Yes. Okay.
Introduction: When death is a loss, not a tragedy. I knew it was coming. With every phone call, every visit home, my dad seemed older. Then one day, he was elderly, hard of hearing, slow, shaky. All those things that happen to old people when they're about to stop. Are you about to write die? Yes? No, not my dad. Well, who's then? But I still need him. Well, you've had him for 47 years. That's not bad. But I'm not successful yet. I'm not married. I'm a renter. He can't die while I'm still a renter. I'm sorry. It's time. But he's only 82. Is that outraged person you? Because it was me in July 2013 when my 82-year-old father was diagnosed with end-stage lung cancer. And it was still me in February of 2014 when he went into hospice. Now, I've been aware of death for a long time. I cried when death took Bambi's mom and cheered when it took Jaws. I was 12 when death took one grandparent and groaned when it came for another. And yet part of me believed that my dad would always be alive. Okay, not part, all. All of me believed my dad was death-proof. That he and I would keep chugging along, with him always being 35 years older than me. Me 60, dad 95, me 70, dad 105, me 80, dad the oldest man in the world. It really seemed like a viable option. Then that thing that happens to everyone happened to me. My dad died. If we are lucky, our nuclear family expands for a few decades. Siblings get married, bringing in-laws and kids. Siblings get remarried, bringing new in-laws and stepkids. The holidays turn into huge affairs. Family photos are standing room only, with our parents sitting proudly in the center. Then, one day the contraction begins. Nature, or God, brings out the axe and starts chopping off the oldest branches of our family tree. That's the best-case scenario, everyone dying in the reverse order they were born. This book is not about a young death or a tragic death. Those waters are too deep. This book is about old people dying, as expected, of old people causes. Specifically, it's about cancer, hospice, funerals, grief, well-meaning friends, and how shocking it is to be parentless for the first time at 48. The book answers questions like, do my friends really care that my 88-year-old mother died? Yes, for about 20 minutes. And then they think, well, she had a nice long life, and go about their day, hoping you don't mention it again. Are there any rules when it comes to administering morphine? The sick person gets the most, and the family gets the rest. Can I shame my dying loved one into living longer? Absolutely. On the 8th of my dad's 10 days in hospice, I introduced my then-boyfriend, who is African-American, to Dad. After the boyfriend left, I said, Dad, if you die today, people will think you're racist. Dad laughed and lived two more days, and I credit my ex for that. How can I make sure my mom's ashes don't fall off the mantle? Well, you can't. Between earthquakes, fracking, and a child's temper tantrum, no mantle can be trusted. That's why the safest place to store ashes is directly in a vacuum cleaner. They're going to end up there anyway, so buy a nice one. Didn't your mom always want a Dyson? Is it okay to be attracted to the soldier who plays taps at your dad's funeral? Yes. While working through grief, you can count on your genitals to lead the way. Speaking of genitals, after a lifetime of avoiding them, is hospice the time where I will accidentally see my father's? Probably. Dying is messy and often involves diapers. When my dad's parents died, he wasn't as upset about losing them as I am about losing him. Why? When your parent was a child, corporal punishment was legal and popular. In 1934 or 35, when my dad was 4 years old, my grandmother introduced him to a retired army general. For reasons Dad was never able to explain, he looked at the general dead in the eye and said, "Damn!" Then he ran for his life. Grandma tore off after him, and when she caught him, she dragged him to the bathroom and washed his mouth out with soap. Growing up, I heard about this one instance more than I ever heard about his time in combat in the Korean War. So I'm not surprised Dad went back to work the day after Grandma died. When I get a drop of shampoo in my mouth in the shower, I'm nauseous for hours. If my dad had ever done that to me, this book would be called Good Riddance. While watching TV, my dying loved one said, "I like this show," then slipped into unconsciousness. Can I rouse him so his last words are more eloquent? Please don't. Disappointment awaits. The next thing out of his mouth could be, "Who are you?" Quotable last words are rare. Dying people have enough on their plate. We shouldn't pressure them into being profound. Besides, "I like this show" might have been a comment on his life, not Judge Joe Brown. Do I correct someone who posts, "Condolences on losing your father, L-O-O-S-I-N-G? No. Reply thank you and be grateful they didn't write your, Y-O-U apostrophe R-E, father. How My Dad Ended Up Dead. Our family's story isn't remarkable. Ron and Joanne Kilmartin married in 1957, and they had two daughters. My name is Laurie. I'm a staff writer on Conan and a stand-up comedian. My sister Eileen is a psychiatrist, not to be confused with My Sister Eileen, a 1955 musical starring Jack Lemmon and Janet Leigh. Dad was hospitalized in July of 2013. One of his arms was double its normal size. A soon-to-be-discovered tumor was causing a blockage. Mom called me and said, "Your father refuses to go to the hospital until he walks the damn dog." She followed him in the car as he walked Pepsi, shouting, "Ron, get in the car!" And I yelled the same thing into my phone from a hotel room in Austin, Texas, where I was working at a comedy club. When I saw Dad in the hospital 2 days later, he was in good spirits, defending his dog walk. He responded to his cancer diagnosis with a grim, "Okay." I went online and found 5 cases of people who lived for years with end-stage lung cancer and assumed Dad would be number 6. The chemo quickly reduced the tumors, and within a week, he was allowed to return home. Dad had more chemo and then radiation to prevent the tumors from metastasizing to his brain. "Don't let all this cancer go to your head, Dad," I said. He died 9 months after being diagnosed with lung cancer. His tumors grew like fetuses we weren't able to abort. We tracked them on x-rays and watched them get bigger and more plentiful. "Hey, look, Dad, it's triplets." But instead of welcoming a new life, we were saying goodbye to an old one. While non-smokers get lung cancer too, my dad smoked 3 or 4 packs a day for 30 years, back when doctors prescribed cigarettes for the flu. He quit when he was 45 after a bout with emphysema. He turned his life around. He became a jogger. He lifted weights and hiked with all of his dogs in hilly parks every single day. And all that time, some shitty little cell was sitting in his lung, waiting for the right moment to turn malignant and multiply. I'm grateful that cancer didn't strike earlier, but it could have waited another 10 years too. My parents still lived in the San Francisco East Bay, where Eileen and I grew up. We both flew home frequently, but Dad's primary caretaker was Mom. He wasn't allowed to eat solid food anymore, so she prepared his nutritional packets and fed him through a tube in his stomach. He was at risk of choking on solid food. Aside from a small bite of salmon during hospice, this was how he consumed calories for the rest of his life. In mid-February, Mom and Dad came to Los Angeles. I took them and my 7-year-old son on a weekend visit to Joshua Tree National Park. Before they flew down, I spoke to his doctor. Dad's tumors were getting bigger, and he needed a new round of chemo. "Should we cancel this trip so he can get his treatment now?" I asked. The doctor said, "No, you should take the trip." That was the doctor's way of telling me that Dad's disease was probably no longer treatable. His cancer was obviously following a trajectory the doctor had seen before. At Joshua Tree, Dad stayed in the car, watching his grandson climb rocks from afar. Dad and Mom returned home on Monday. The final chemo was administered on Tuesday. We were told it would work immediately or not at all. It worked not at all. Dad was admitted to home hospice on Thursday, February 20th. Eileen and I both flew back on Friday morning. Dad liked charts and graphs, so we stuck a whiteboard calendar on the wall. We ordered Dad to drag this hospice thing out as long as possible and gave him his first goal: live until the end of February. Every day that began with Dad breathing was marked with a red X. One of us would draw the X dramatically and say, "You did it!" It was our version of Jerry Seinfeld's "Don't Break the Chain." Dad died on Sunday, March 2nd, ensuring that Mom got both her and Dad's March Social Security checks. Ron Kilmartin was diligent like that. The Dying Reader.
Planning your own death. Should you sneak out the back door like Bowie? When you find yourself in the dying stage of your life and everything feels out of your control, remember there are 2 decisions you still get to make. Who do you tell, and when do you tell them? Let's examine your options, none of which are good. 1, tell your family. You may be thinking, let's keep it small. You are a modest person. You don't want to make a big to-do, as your generation says. Well, that is sweet and so, so naive. Allow me to describe the world you are about to leave, the one cooked up by these awful Generation X and millennial descendants of yours. There was no such thing as private, personal, or keeping it in the family. Grief is now a shared commodity. You might tell just your immediate family, but one of your shithead relatives will tell everyone. Because that is how we suffer now, publicly, with hashtags. Come to think of it, you may be departing at just the right time. Because almost every word you say now is being tweeted by a boy or girl grandchild named Taylor. Option two, tell no one. Oh, a tough guy. You're just gonna keep your PET scans to yourself and then drop dead one day? Maybe you don't wanna cause a fuss. Well, since you are clearly no expert on emotions, let me be the first to warn you, this death will indeed cause a fuss. In your wake and at your wake, you'll leave a funeral home full of loved ones who will never get what psychologists call closure. Closure is a thing that people less macho than you need. It helps them sleep at night. And if you don't give it to them, they will resent you forever and ignore all the good stuff you ever did. You're robbing people of their grand goodbye. And people like their grand goodbyes. They practice them in the shower like Oscar acceptance speeches. It's a conscience clearer. Prodigal sons want to come home, ex-wives want to forgive, and neighbors want to admit it was they who stole your newspapers all those years. Think of the squirming, the groveling, all the people saying, "You know what, Pop? You were right." It's life's last gift, vindication. You don't want to miss it. Remember, everyone deserves one last bedside hug. Stop making your death about you and go out like Deborah Winger in terms of endearment. Option three, tell everyone. Do you have your own Facebook presence? Have your posts been suffering from a lack of attention lately? Well, get an agent because you're about to become famous. Once you announce your prognosis, people will be drawn to you like a moth to a flame that's about to go out. And guess what? It's nice to have strangers pulling for you. We should all have a random Australian post, "I'm praying for you, mate." Instead of golf claps from family members weak from despair, a Facebook death means a round of applause from people you've never met. Honestly, the best time to get famous is when you're dying. The public doesn't have time to get sick of you. There's no backlash or frantic attempt at a comeback. And just as your new fans are getting to know you, poof, you are gone. Too soon. The tricky thing is figuring out when to post about your situation. You may have strength early in your hospice, but it goes quickly. Give yourself a few days to bask in the love. Drop your impending death post at midnight like Beyonce dropped lemonade. Then let your loved ones take over. They can read good wishes to you and respond for you. It gives them something else to do at your bedside besides cry. The risk here is that, like before you are dying, you may be unable to stop checking to see who liked your post.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.